Good morning, everybody, and welcome. It is time for Ridgewood Live right here on this September the 5th, 2021, here in the heart of the Arkansas Delta. Good morning, everybody. I'm Pastor Jim. Welcome. We are so glad that you are here. We're so glad that you have chosen Ridgewood as your place of worship. Today, we want to encourage you to go ahead and get settled in, get your Bibles, get your journals, and get ready for an incredible day of worship and diving deeper into God's Word. Well, I'm going to be in James chapter 3. If you want to go ahead and thumb mark your Bibles and get ready, that's James chapter 3. We'll start at that very first verse. In the meantime, when you get in this morning, we want to encourage you to say hello. Make sure that you let us know that you're here. Let us know that you're watching. If you're new to us, let us know where you're watching from. And then we also want to encourage you to make sure that you engage all through the service. You can hit that thumbs up button, the like button, or the heart button, the love, or that care emoji. You can do that all through the service. We're going to have a great day here today. And in addition, please do us the favor and be a part of our ministry, and that is to hit the share button. The share button puts it over into your newsfeed, which is available then to your friends and your family right here on Facebook. That is just our precious request, is that you hit the share button and help us to share the gospel as far as we possibly can. Well, if you are new to us, we want to encourage you to go to our website, lovemyrbc.com, and click on guest card and take a couple of minutes and fill that out for us. In addition, if you are watching online and you have not had a chance to get your tithes and offerings sent into the church, we want to encourage you to make sure that you do that, and don't forget, that's a major part of your worship. You can send that in just a regular check to the post office, Box 785 here in Four City. That's Ridgewood Baptist Church, P.O. Box 785. And that is 4 City 72336. And also, you can also go right back to our website, lovemyrbc.com, and click on online giving right there across the top. Makes it super easy for you to do that. You can set it up for a one-time gift, or you can set it up on a regular donation. We just want to encourage you to make sure that you do that, and don't forget it. And you still got time to invite others to watch with you. You can share this, you can tag them, you can send it in a message, whatever the case may be. Just know that we are glad you're here. We love you guys, and we'll be starting at 10:30.
For the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world. Yeah.
All right, folks, you guys about ready? It is about time for service to start. Again, we're going to be in James chapter 3. If you want to go ahead and thumb mark your Bibles, please say hello. Please engage. Right now, just want to test your thumbs out. Go ahead and hit that heart button, everybody. And let's just get that heart button light it up right now with that heart button. We love you guys so very much, and we'll be talking with you after the service. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. We're going to get there in just a minute. Everybody go ahead and stand on up and let's worship this morning.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior.
About that cross. Amen? And even though it was just, two old pieces of wood and three rusty nails, what took place on that cross is still changing lives today. Amen. And we can never forget that. Because without the cross, you and I are not here today. Without the cross, you and I don't have eternal life, folks. Aren't you thankful for Jesus and what he did on that cross? Let's sing it out. All to hear, far away, stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that glorious, well-dearest and blessed, for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the horn of it lost, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world as a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory.
Sing it out.
Stained with blood, so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and save. Yes. people said.
Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, Satan should buffet, though trials should come. They're coming, amen? Mm-hmm. Listen to this. Let this blessed assurance control. When my faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall seated. Brother Tommy Hanner, would you care to come up and just lead us in a word of prayer before you sit down? So would you come up and just do that for us?
Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we just thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for the rain you sent our way. We just thank you for Ridgewood Baptist Church. We thank you for this opportunity to be in your house here today, Lord. We pray, Lord, for those that we know that has lost loved ones this week. We pray for the families. We pray for the loved ones. We pray for those days where sadness has set in. We just pray you'll give them strength to get through all of this. Lord, we just thank you for all you do. We pray for our pastor. Brother Jim, as it comes and opens your word, Lord, you speak to us through you, Lord Jesus Christ. We just thank you for all of this. We thank you for what's going to take place. We pray you'll be with us this coming week. And we ask, Lord, that you forgive us where we fail thee. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Tommy.
Well, I don't know about you, but it's pretty easy to say we have been with the Lord this morning in worship. Holy cow. Ladies, thank you. Thank you. That was powerful. That was powerful. Folks, we're going to be in James chapter 3. If you want to go ahead and kind of migrate over that direction, James chapter 3. It is so good to be back with you today. Good to see everybody that's here. And if you're watching online, welcome. We are glad that you are with us today, that you chose Ridgewood as your place of worship. And if you are online, let me just say that we want to encourage you to just kind of engage and get connected. Please say hello. Let us know that you're watching. You can hit that like, love, or care button at any time during our service. And then we want to also encourage you to always share that button. Hit that share button and share the broadcast, as we are doing our best to take the gospel as far and as fast as we possibly can. Okay, did everybody have a good day with the kickoff of college football this weekend? Everybody, yes? Yes, everybody get to watch the Razorbacks? I didn't. I heard they won. I heard they barely won. They had to, it's like the Razorbacks played the last half. Is that right? Is that what I heard? They played the last half, so they didn't play the first half. I can tell you that the boys from the Bayou just kind of kicked a bucket last night on the West Coast. That was kind of ugly. But man, if somewhere in the middle of this message, I just need you to understand something. I'm doing my best to try to wrap up my sermon, and I've got Alabama playing right over here on the side, and I'm trying to keep up with it. So somewhere in my notes, I know there's going to be a thing that I've typed out. Then Jesus said, touchdown Alabama. So I know that's coming somewhere. I can't find it. I've gone through the notes. I'm like, Lord, please don't let that be in there. So if it does, then y'all just know exactly what taking place. I have to say that just being able to watch some of the clips and parts of the game yesterday and watching the crowds of people, and who knows what's going to come out of that, but it just looked good to see things getting back to normal with football. Our life has been flipped upside down over the past almost 2 years, and yesterday was a sense of normalcy, and I thank the Lord for that. I did learn yesterday that, of course, you know, last year football season wasn't true football season to me. And so I've gotten out of the routine of making sure that the message is done before Saturday. So I got to rethink my whole schedule all week long, because I love college football. And I've got to get to where I can watch it, because if not, y'all going to have a whole lot of touchdown Alabamas in the sermons on Sunday. So we got to really watch that. Okay, last week in James. Last week in James, in chapter 2, I want us to reflect a little bit about that. We asked this question. We asked the question, we can talk the talk, but are we walking the talk? That was the whole thrust of everything that we looked at the end of James chapter 2. We saw that James had brought in what a worthless faith looked like. Then we saw what a wicked faith looks like. Then we saw what a worthy faith looked like. And then as we ended last week, James was telling us that any person who claims Christianity, who claims faith, but doesn't have the works to justify those claims are basically just like a lifeless corpse on an embalmer's table. They are dead. And then we ask ourselves this question, am I honestly putting into practice what I claim? Or am I simply just all talk? Am I just wearing a mask? Am I simply pretending? I truly, truly hope and pray that each of us has had the opportunity this week to do some soul searching, to take some deep, honest looks at ourselves in the mirror on that question. Am I walking
my talk. I pray that God has spoke to you deeply. I pray that God has convicted you on some things. Because today, if you thought last week was deep, today James is going to take us another level, even deeper, in chapter 3. While we looked last week at talking the talk and walking the talk, this week, y'all, we're going to have to ask ourselves this question. Am I really talking the talk? Y'all with me? Is what I'm saying the real deal? James chapter 3, look at verses 1 and 2. James says this, My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man. That word translates mature man. He is a mature man. Able also to bridle the whole body. Can we just admit today that James does not have a filter? I mean, there is no filter on him. Have you ever run into anybody that didn't have a filter? I mean, you just walked up and it just popped out. James is that guy. He doesn't have a filter. He just lays the truth out there without any hesitation, without any fear of consequences, and without any worry of hurting your feelings. Isn't that a refreshing thing? See, we have a problem in today's world that we will notoriously back off the truth so that we don't hurt anybody's feelings. Somebody might pout. Oh, you hurt my feelings. It's everywhere. And church, it has made its way into our pulpits. Y'all know this. It's here. It's in every denomination. Our pulpits are filled with men and women, and that's a whole nother sermon in and of itself, which, by the way, I'm just going to make this statement and get out of it. A woman in the pulpit is unbiblical. Done. Unbiblical. If you disagree with me, see me after church, and I can prove it to you. It's all in Scripture. But our pulpits today are filled with people who are more concerned about motivational speeches and feel-good, warm, fuzzy messages that just won't hurt your feelings. Amen. It's everywhere. And now that everybody and their brother turned into a Facebook evangelist in March of 2020, all you got to do is pick and choose what you want to listen to, and you will find them. They're here. They're on television. They're on radios. They're on podcasts. They're everywhere. We even have pastors that are cherry-picking scriptures to fit a narrative. I use this statement. Matter of fact, I think I've talked about it this past week. We have pastors that are out here that will preach the exact same message Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, but they change the text. But the message is still the same. Have y'all ever seen those guys? Y'all ever done that? Okay, I make this statement about those guys. Their preaching is 10 miles wide and a half inch deep. Right? Folks, if your pastor... And I'm talking about me here. If your pastor does not take you several feet or several miles deep any time that he is teaching or preaching, something ain't right in the pulpit. It's just not. Your Sunday school teachers need to be taking you to another level. That's why we get into this text here that James is talking about. But we've got pastors that couldn't exegete their way out of a wet paper bag if you paid them. They don't even know what the word exegete means. They just want to tell good stories and make you feel good. They don't want to hurt your feelings. Let me tell you something. If the scripture hurts your feelings, it ain't my fault. It ain't my fault. It is my fault if I don't tell you about it. It's my fault if I don't lay this out and break this open and peel back the layers. I'm held accountable for that. I don't ever want to be known as a guy who sugarcoated the gospel. Never, ever, ever. Somebody says that, you need to direct them to me because I need to know what you're thinking. I need to understand because I want to correct that. Sunday school teachers, the same way, whether it's here or at any church. We've got Sunday school teachers that never studied their lesson until they walk into their classrooms on Sunday morning. I've seen that over the years. What do you think about that, Miss Pat? I don't get it. We've got Sunday school teachers that are convinced that they can take their quarterly and they can walk in on any given Sunday morning and not crack that thing open, much less dive into Scripture and read the content of the quarterly and then ask questions. Okay, do you have any comments? You got any questions? And that be the lesson. No. We've got to be able to take the Scripture that God's given us and the text that they've given us and to work it in and to be able to share with a class exactly what God has given you. Somebody say amen to that. That's what Sunday school teachers are about. That's what teachers and preachers are all about. Yesterday, Ms. Denise and I both posted something on Facebook, and it's a great quote from Charles Spurgeon, and it's a perfect fit for our text today. Dr. Spurgeon writes this: "Do not go where it is all fine music, grand talk, and beautiful architecture. Go where the gospel is preached, and go often." It doesn't get any clearer than that. There is a greater accountability on the teachers and the preachers of God's words than on any other. And James says, hey, do y'all see this? James says that this accountability is so great that those who do become teachers will receive a stricter judgment. Y'all see that? That's in verse 1. Notice the word "we." James considers himself one. James considers himself more accountable than others that are not teachers. He says, "We shall receive a stricter judgment." This is a sobering thought, a sobering warning for anyone who is or who would be a teacher of God's word. We have to take that responsibility very serious. And James says, "Let not many of you become teachers." Not everybody in the church, not every person in the church is a teacher, and not every person should teach. But if God is laying it on your heart and He is convicting you to teach a class, then bless God, you need to teach a class. I mean, you need to quit playing with God. If He's leading you to do something, you simply need to do it. When we go back and we dissect the New Testament church, and you can do this, but I'm going to give you a launch pad into it. Well, when we dissect the New Testament church, we find that teaching is the primary factor of the spread of the gospel and the catalyst for life change. Let me give you some examples, and these are not going to be on the screen. When Jesus began His Sermon on the Mount, Matthew writes in Matthew 5:2, "Then He opened His mouth and taught them." Later on, Matthew 7:28-29, when Jesus finished His Sermon on the Mount, Matthew writes, "And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at His teaching, for He taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes." Church, hear what that scripture just says. They were astonished at His teaching. Do you see that? Do you hear that? Okay, this does not say that those multitudes that was on the mountainside when they were pulled up to Jesus and the disciples, it does not say that they were astonished at His guitar playing, at His piano playing, at His singing, at His social media expertise, at His yard mowing, or at His casserole making abilities. Amen. It says they were blown away. They were astonished by His teaching. Mark 6:2. "And when the Sabbath had come, He began to teach in the synagogue." Then down in Mark 6, we find that Jesus marveled because of their unbelief. "Then He went about the villages in a circuit teaching." Acts 5:25. The apostles are on trial again. Someone came to the high priest and kind of tattled on them. They go to the high priest, they go to the captain of the temple, and they said this: "Look, the men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people." Titus 1:9. Paul insisted to Titus that he hold fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine but to exhort and convict those who contradict. Paul to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15 told him, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And then two chapters later in 2 Timothy 4:2, he told Timothy simply three little words, preach the word. Preach the word. Teaching is vital in the life of the church. And then he went on to tell Timothy, be ready, let's be ready to preach, be ready in season and out of season. Here's your quote you need to write down. This is something you need to post if you're on social media. It's something we need to understand day in and day out, and it's this. The centrality of any church must be the teaching and the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can be meeting in a one-room shotgun building. Dirt floors, handmade pews. I've sat on those, guys. No air conditioning, coal oil lamps. But as long as the preaching and the teaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ is the heartbeat of that church, then nothing else matters. Doesn't matter. James says in verse 2, for we all stumble in many things. Again, that word we, he's including himself in what he's saying to the churches. He doesn't in no way excuse his own personal stumbling. He's admitting it here. You see, this greater accountability of teachers is sobering in the light of our common weaknesses, because we do stumble in so many things. I've stumbled all week long. Anybody else say that? I mean, I've stumbled all week long. The Greek word here that we get the term stumble from doesn't imply a fatal fall at all. It means something that trips us up or slows us down in order to hinder our spiritual walk. Paul talks about that a lot, doesn't he? Have you run into something this week that wanted to reach out and grab you to slow you down in your spiritual walk? Most of us have. James says, if anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man. He's a mature man. James says, does not stumble in word. Y'all catch that? In word. He does not stumble in word. See, right here, James is giving us a way to measure spiritual maturity, not only for teachers, but for Christians as a whole, by our words. Matthew chapter 12, verses 34 through 37, Jesus makes it clear that words are the true revelation of the inner character of a person. Jesus is speaking to a group of Pharisees, and he says this, brood of vipers. In other words, you pit of snakes. How can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure, which is the evil treasure of his heart, brings forth evil things. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give an account of it in the day of judgment. Verse 37, you might want to underline this. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. I told you James doesn't have a filter. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. I have heard it said like this. Whatever is in a person's heart comes out of their mouths. Have y'all heard that? Whatever's in a person's heart comes out of their mouth. No exception to that. It's going to erupt. Okay. We stumble in word. We stumble in word when we focus on self-bragging or self-exaggeration or always trying to one-up somebody, focusing on whatever makes us look good. We stumble in word with our gossip, our slander, our destructive criticism, with our cruelty, with our anger, with being two-faced, or when we try to flatter someone with insincere words. James ends this verse 2, by saying that if we're able to not stumble in word, then we're able to bridle, or we're able to control or harness our whole body. And with that, James is going to transition, talking about being able to bridle, being able to control. He's going to transition into the next part of this passage, because right now when we shift into verse 3 to the rest of this section in verse 12, if we can get there, through verse 12, is James's way of, you know, I love you, but I'm about to hit you in the mouth, because it's coming. I told Miss Denny just a little bit ago before we walked up, I said, have you ever went to get a slice of pie, but you wanted it to be twice as big? Come on, y'all know. Today, James gives us a double slice. This is that big mouth-watering cheesecake that we all like, that we normally just get nitpicks of and bites of and samples of. Well, right now, James is about to slice half of that bad boy and lay it out here. Because in verse 3, James takes the gloves off. He's no longer Mr. Nice Guy. He loves you. He loves the church. But he takes the gloves off and he comes out swinging. We have to remember, this is written to the church. People act lost, they talk lost, and they live lost. Why? Because they are lost. And so if you've got somebody that's out here that's acting like the devil, talking like the devil, living like the devil, even though they're members of a church and they might attend on Sundays, guess what? Most probably lost. Amen. Come on. We're laying it out there. So this text is to the believer. It's to the Christian. Verse 3. He says, indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn their whole body. Look also at ships. Although they are so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles? And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire by hell. Well, thank you, James, for that 1-2 punch in the face. The power of the tongue. Undoubtedly, it's one of the smallest members of our body. Yet the power that our tongue has is horrifying. You just think about it. Even though our little toe is probably a little bit smaller, or any of our toes is a little bit smaller than the tongue. But you know something? The tongue can do more damage than the little toe. Amen? Tongue can do more damage than a little finger. Think about it. The tongue is... it's gnarly. James compares the mere size of the tongue with its incredible power to three things that are also small yet controls lots of power. Number one, he compares it to the bit in a horse's mouth. Then he compares it to the rudder of a ship. And then he compares it to a small spark that ignites a forest fire. Now, a bit and a rudder are distinctively small in comparison to a horse or ship, right? Okay, I mean, it is. We know a bit's like this. It's about that long and maybe about that big around. Okay, it's not, you would You would imagine a small straw, just a little bit bigger. And that's what's in a horse's mouth. But even though small, they're extremely important. You see, the use of the bit in the horse's mouth controls the entire direction of the horse. And the use of the rudder controls the entire direction of the ship. If you don't have a rudder, then you're left to your own out there with a paddle. Amen? I mean, you just are. So the rudder controls the whole ship. And what James is saying here is that our lives are steered, controlled by our words, by the use of our tongues, for good or for bad. That's why it is imperative that we be careful which words we use. And when we really look at the power and the importance of a ship's rudder, we need to understand that the rudder not only shifts the direction of the ship itself in the way that the captain is commanding, but it's also used many, many times to stabilize that ship. And of course, it helps the people that's on it during violent storms that a ship might find itself in. And so what James is saying here is that controlling our words, controlling our tongue, controls the direction not only for our lives, but in many ways the lives of others. James says in verse 4, see how great a forest a little fire kindles. We've been talking in the mornings about the Caldor fire that is on the west coast that is really, really close to completely wiping out South Lake Tahoe. And that's not the only one. There's been many up close to where Danny and Lindsay are in Spokane, many on that western seaboard. And do you know something? Those fires that are ravaging, that are out of control, guess what? They're started by one little bitty flick of a match, one spark. I dare say that if you've had junk piles out in your yards or leaves or pine straw or something that you wanted to burn, it didn't take but one little flick of a bick to get it started, did it? Just one little flame. And James says that our tongue is like that spark of that fire. And can we just be honest with ourselves today? The fire of the tongue has been used to burn many people. How many of you have been burned by someone's words? I think we all have. How many of us have used our words to burn someone else? Again, I think we're all kind of guilty. We've all heard the saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words can never hurt me. You heard that? That's a lie. That's a lie. You see, the truth is, the hurt and the bitterness, the fire of a word that is spoken against us can cause us pain for a lifetime, long after a bone that is broken heals. I would dare say that most of us in this room can recall at least a time that someone has said something about you or a family member, and even though you may have forgiven them, you have not forgotten it. Am I right? Have I just waded off into some deep water? Y'all know I'm true to it right here. We can forgive it. It's really, really hard to forget it. So when we look at these three illustrations that James gives us, the bit, the rudder, the spark, the Bible is pretty clear that our tongue can either control or destroy. See, look at it like this. What others say to us and what we say to others can and most often does last a lifetime, whether it's for good or for evil. A sarcastic remark, a critical remark, can cause lasting pain on someone. And in like manner, a compliment or an encouragement can lift someone up, can inspire them, not only for the moment, but for years to come. Words. The use of the tongue not only has the power to impact our life and other lives positively, but they also have the potential to destroy life. James says the tongue is a fire. It is a world of iniquity. Let's break that word iniquity down. James says that the tongue is a fire. It is a world of sin. a world of evil, a world of immorality, and this is the word that most normally is associated with iniquity. The tongue is a fire. It is a world of wickedness. It's what we normally get out of it. So just as we cannot underestimate the power of a horse's bit or the rudder of a ship or the spark of a fire, we cannot underestimate the capacity of what our tongue can hold. No other body part has the same capacity for destruction as our tongues. I love this quote I read this past week. We've all heard of the famed evangelist. He was a Methodist evangelist. His name was John Wesley. Has everybody heard the name John Wesley? John Wesley told the story. He said that at the end of one of his revival meetings, he said that he had a person, this was a lady, he had a lady walk up to him, and she was so proud of herself, and she had listened there, and she had done real good in that revival meeting. And she walks up to Brother Wesley, and he says, "Brother Wesley, I pride myself in speaking my mind. That is my talent." Wesley replied, "Well, the Lord wouldn't mind if he buried that talent." Amen, right? There's absolutely no possible way that we can sit down and try to rationalize and reduce the utter disgust that James has for the devastating powers of our speech. And if James is writing this to the church at that point, can you imagine what James is seeing and what he is trying to address? He's trying to get a handle on it. And that's what I'm saying. He pulls no punches. He has no filter. He is making sure he gets the point across to those first century believers. Look at the end of verse 6. "The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature as it is set on fire by hell." James says our tongue is so set among our members that it defiles our whole body. Our tongue can corrupt everything else about us. Think about it. When someone says something kind of nasty to you or hurtful to you, the rest of them don't matter, does it? You don't care how good their hair looks or if they're wearing brand new Nikes or super clothing. You don't care if they just left the beauty shop or not. You don't care if they live in the finest homes or drive the finest car. Their words hurt. And that's all that matters. James says our tongue is set on fire by hell. I don't want us to misunderstand that statement, okay? That might be one of those you want to underline. It is set on fire by hell. The phrase that is translated hell in this text comes from two Hebrew words that give us a location, that give us a place. It's called the Valley of Hinnom, H-I-N-N-O-M. The Valley of Hinnom. The Valley of Hinnom is a place outside the city of Jerusalem. Now, we all know that most towns have garbage dumps, right? I'm sure Four Cities got one. I'm sure Wynn's got one. Marianna's got one. Everybody's got a place for the dump. Now, if you live out in the county like I do, we generally burn things out back. Amen? But most cities have garbage dumps. And if you've ever been one, they don't smell the best in the world. They don't look real good. Well, the Valley of Hinnom not only was a garbage dump, but it was a place where the Jews and where others would take their dead animals. Well, that looks good, don't it? That's amazing. That's pretty. Smells right, doesn't it? It's also a place that many people would take the corpses. Dead bodies were out there. Many times they would burn. But what set the Valley of Hinnom apart was the reputation that it had from centuries before James wrote this letter. Because centuries before we get this document, the Valley of Hinnom was the place of pagan sacrifices where they burned children alive. Yeah, you heard me right. In an effort to worship a little g god, people would take their babies and put them on an altar and stick a match to it. Now, I want you to listen in your mind to the cries and the pleas for help of those children. My grandson's 3 years old. And I can tell you right now, y'all would have to shoot me to keep me from going after him and getting him off that thing. You would have to kill me to get that baby off. And I would dare say that each of you would do the same thing for your children and for your grandchildren. And so can you imagine the disgust that went on at this place and what it was used for? What this did, y'all, what this did was this was the launch pad to what we have today for this beastly murdering process called abortion. This is where it started, in the Valley of Hinnom. Because in a means of worship. And by the way, how can you worship anything when it meant by killing your baby? Come on. Come on, I can't grab that. And what James says is that this place, known for the slaughter of innocent babies, that had now morphed into a burning garbage dump for dead animals and humans. That our tongue is set on fire by that. Don't throw your hymn books at Jim Bob, okay? Because it ain't me saying that. That's scripture, amen? That's scripture. Now, I don't want us to get confused here. Because Jesus also used the word hell, but he used it in a different text. He used it to refer to the place of lost souls that are going to spend an eternity that don't know him as their Lord and Savior. Okay? So I don't want us to get confused here. So for James to use the same Greek terms that Jesus did when he talked about that eternal damnation of the physical location of hell, what James is telling us here is that the tongue that's in our mouths has the destructive powers that are motivated and encouraged by none other than hell itself. You know, I could stop right here and just leave it with this and say, we probably need to watch what we say. Amen? And then we roll on into verse 7 and 8, and James is, he is crystal clear that no one can tame their tongue. Look at verse 7. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and creature of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind, but no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Now you think about that. James says that the wildest of animals can be tamed. The wildest of beasts in the field. Imagine all the critters that you've ever seen that's on television and rolling around in the Sahara, or that's rolling around in the waters. And we've got some slimy things that's in the waters of this world, okay? I mean, it's gnarly. It is beastly. It is ugly. But every wild animal that you've ever seen at a zoo, everything that you can possibly imagine can be tamed and can be brought under control. But the tongue that's in our mouths cannot. James says, no man can tame the tongue. But let me just share this with you. While you and I cannot tame the tongue that's in our mouth, I can assure you that the tongue that's in our mouth can be brought under control under the power and the direction of the Holy Spirit. Now that it can be. What we have to do is we got to be willing to listen to the Spirit, and then we got to do what the Holy Spirit is leading us to do, or in this case, to say. Then James says that our tongue is even more dangerous when we look at the fact that it is full of deadly poison. Your tongue and your mouth is full of deadly poison. See, most of y'all are going to go home and y'all going to go out to eat and you're going to say, did that preacher just say that my mouth is dirty? Yes, he did. That preacher said that my tongue is full of poison. No, he didn't. Scripture did. The word poison, well, this is great. We've been studying King David in the mornings on our morning coffee chat, which, by the way, you do not want to miss tomorrow morning as we are in the thick of chapter 11 in 2 Samuel. But the word poison here is the same word that King David uses in Psalm 140. David writes this in Psalm 140, first three verses. He says, deliver me, O Lord, from evil men. Preserve me from violent men who plan evil things in their hearts. They continually gather together for war. They sharpen their tongues like a serpent. The poison of asp is under their lips. Selah. Now I want us to get a clearer picture of verse 3. The New Living Translation of verse 3 reads like this. Their tongues sting like a snake. The venom of a viper drips from their lips. Now that's what James is talking about. The tongue. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. Words hold the power. Not only to guide us through sound teaching like we talked about when we first started verses 1 and 2, but it's clear that they also hold the power to destroy. And then as James wraps up this text in verse 9, James is going to talk about the inconsistencies of our tongue. Let's start, verse 9. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude. And let me just go ahead and tell you that is the word likeness, that have been made in the likeness of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be. Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter from the same opening? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? Thus, no spring yields both salt water and fresh. The inconsistencies of our tongue. The same tongue that's in our mouth is used to bless God and curse men. Now you think about that. We use our tongue for the highest calling, that's to bless our God, and then we can use it also for the lowest of evil when somebody does us wrong or somebody takes our parking spot or cuts us off in traffic. I'll pick on Dr. Jones or gets a better fishing hole. Have you ever had little things that you just go, and those were, come on. You just growl. At no time should it be said of any Christian that out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. Now you see, we actually have a biblical example of what James is talking about. Can you think about it? We've got a great example. We know him. We know him as the disciple with a foot-shaped mouth. Simon Peter. Perfect textbook example of what James is talking about here. Simon Peter, with his tongue, proclaimed that Jesus Christ was the Son of the living God. And just a little while later, with that same tongue, he denied Jesus not once, not twice, but three times, and he did it with cursing. And what James is laying out here is that Christians shouldn't be talking out of both sides of their mouth. You ever seen somebody who did that? Our speech as believers should be consistently bringing glory to our God, our Father. Consistently. We should never have one set of words that we use on Sundays and another set of words that we use for the other 6 days. And sadly, I think we all can admit we've seen others that do that. James brings this to a close. by making it clear that a spring of water cannot bring forth fresh water and bitter water or fresh and salt water from the exact same opening. And then to drive that point even clearer, James says that under no circumstances can a fig tree produce olives, and likewise an olive tree cannot produce figs. Now you see, this entire text ties us to where James was last week. We can talk the talk, but are we walking the talk? And then James now says, but are we really talking the talk? Are we really laying down what we say we're laying down? You can create the prettiest little label on Microsoft Word or in Photoshop or do whatever, and you can make that dude say olive tree. And you can go out here and you can hang that on a fig tree, but I'm going to tell you something, that label does not make the fig tree an olive tree. The same thing, you can put a label on a person that says Christian. They can go to Sunday school, attend church, throw money in a tithing tote, even be baptized, have your name on a church membership roll, but none of that makes you a Christian. I mean, it's a perfect correlation. You can trim, you can shape a fig tree to look like an olive tree, but it doesn't make it an olive tree. You can put a fig tree in an olive tree grove, but it doesn't make it an olive tree. Now, for those of you who know me well, you know that I'm not allowed near tools. I'm not allowed near hammers or saws or anything like that because I break things. But I have always heard this statement, and I bet most of you guys are going to understand what I say. And this is the statement, especially in dealing with carpentry. And the statement goes like this: measure twice, cut once. Y'all heard that? Norval, I bet you've, Norval is the main, okay? If you've got to cut a board and you need it 36 inches long, you measure that board and you mark it once. But to make sure that you need it 36 inches, you go back to that opening, right? And you measure that opening again, right? And then you go back to that board and you remeasure out to 36 inches. Is that what that means? Somebody help me out here. Like I said, I'm totally ignorant when it comes to that. Measure twice, cut once. Because what I have heard is that many times when you only measure once, you screw that thing up and you end up having to cut twice. Anybody ever had to cut twice because of that? Woo! Dr. Jones says all day long. I bet you that was one of Larry's main things that he taught his kids in FFA. Like I said, I ain't got a clue. Well, you know, maybe. Based on what James has to say. Maybe that same principle needs to be said about our words. Maybe we should think twice before we even consider speaking one. And all God's people said, amen. Will you bow with me this morning? Father, your word, oh my, sledgehammers, Lord, to the Christian. Hard lessons that we all need. Truths that we need to hear, truths that we need to apply to our lives. Father, I would dare say that everybody in this building and everybody that's watching or will watch has struggled with the words that's come out of their mouths. And I'll be the first, Lord, to admit. Sometimes my tongue is loose, is tied in the middle and loose at both ends and doesn't know when to stop. Father, this message has convicted me. Lord, I know for a fact I need to think twice before I speak one. Lord, I'm thankful that your word is always true. It's sharper, powerful than a two-edged sword. Father, today, if there is anyone here in our online family that has struggled with this, that is struggling with this today, may this be the day that they get on their knees and they make hard decisions and changes in their life. Maybe this is the day we just need to go tell somebody we're sorry. Father, if there's anybody that is here or even watching online that does not know you as their personal Savior, Father, I just ask you that you would draw them to you. Father, that this would be the day that they break free and claim you as their Lord and Savior and ask you to be Lord of their lives and to forgive them of their sins. God, as we enter into this time of quiet, Father, may your will be done in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, with every head bowed, every eye closed, we're going to have some soft music that's going to be playing. And this is just going to be an opportunity for you to come to this altar and to pray, or maybe go get someone and go pray.
Wonderful Savior,
words.
I know for sure.
Maybe somebody needs to hear an encouraging word. Maybe somebody needs to hear you tell them you love them.
Crafted into your perfect.
Maybe somebody needs to hear you tell them, look, I understand what you're going through. I'm right here with you. This altar is for Jesus' name. Amen. All right. In the way of announcements, let me grab this right quick. We've got several things I want to bring to your attention. Starting next, where's Gloria? Starting Sunday, the 12th, is going to be our week of Dixie Jackson offering. Starts next Sunday. Is that right, Gloria? We are going to have offering envelopes for you. This is all state missions. Money that will all go strictly to that. Everything stays in the state of Arkansas. So this week, be praying how much God wants you to give toward Dixie Jackson. We'll have those envelopes ready for you. Also, Brother Tommy and Brother Norval and I met with some others this past week. For those of you on our building and remodel committee, and I can simply say this, we're real close to begin. And I don't want to use the term remodel, but putting things back in place. Am I right, Brother Tommy? We're real close, okay? We have heard from our insurance company. We are narrowing down what is and what isn't and amounts. And I mean, we're closer than you can imagine. And so I would dare say, at least I know in my own personal mind, I hope that you can see some type of construction being done before the end of September. Would you agree, Brother Tommy? At least that's a goal. We'll call that a goal, okay? So we're that close. So just be in prayer. We'll keep you updated as we go. Next Monday night, that is not tomorrow, next Monday night. This is Monday the 13th at 6:30. It is the Tri-County Association of Women's Rally. It is going to be at the Worship Center at the campground. That is at 6:30. The speaker is Tammy Camp Beardsley. I have no idea who this lady is. Tammy, does anybody know? Tammy Camp Beardsley. Okay, she's going to be speaking. That starts at 6:30. There is no meal, but refreshments will be served. So, ladies, if you would like to go, this is the information. That is next week at the camp. So, you might want to talk about carpooling and all that good stuff. Then, 2 weeks from tomorrow, which will be the 20th, is going to be the Associational Men's Rally, and it is going to be at Cherry Valley. And same thing, it's going to be at 6:30, no meal. Surely with Clayton, we can scare up some coffee. So, guys, if y'all want to go, we need to be talking about it and forming carpool. So that is all coming up. Also, on the 1st of November, if somebody's got a calendar out, you might want to look at this. The 1st of November should be a Monday, okay? It should be a Monday. Somebody help me out here. Look on our calendars. Who's got it? Okay. It is a Monday. Okay, November the 1st is the date of our Tri-County Associational Annual Meeting. Okay? That is the annual meeting. And I do not have the location. It's in Wynn somewhere. It is going to be a one-night thing. It is open to all members of all churches. We will need to have designees and messengers other than and in addition to the executive board members to go and to vote. And I would like for us to take as many messengers as possible, because one of the things that is coming up on the plate for us is that there is a proposal brought to the executive board, and it will be voted on that night, to sell the Tri-County Associational Campground. Okay? It's an incredible thing. I'm not going to get into it right here. If you want to talk about it, I'll talk to you after services. But that is going to be up, and it is strictly to put it up for sale, and then the actual sale will take place in weeks and months to come. So that is a big deal. There's also a couple other things that's coming that really need our attention and it needs our support. And so I know Brother Larry's going to be there, Miss Pam's going to be there, I'm going to be there, Lord willing. And like I said, it is open to everyone, and I will give you more and more detail as that comes. The 2nd or 3rd of October, it's the first Saturday in October, is Acts 1:8. It is the 2nd, thank you. Is October 2nd, it's Acts 1:8, it is in Russellville. As of today, it is still on, and I got an email on Friday that says that it is still being planned. So that is the one-day mission trip where everybody converges in one location and goes in different directions for that day. If you want to go, there's information back on that table that you can find. There's a registration link. You can go and sign up. I can tell you up front, I will not be able to go, but that is all there. Okay, any other word? Have I missed anything? Say it again. Thank you. Miss Sandra Powell's service will be tomorrow. I know it's at Stevens. What is the time? It is at...
The visitation is at 10.
Okay, 10 till... Help me out. Okay, it's from 10 to 11, and the service is at 11. That is at Stevens. That's Miss Sandra Powell's. I talked with her son, Larry, what's his name, Jimmy? Okay, I talked with him on Friday, I believe, and he was very much appreciative of our church support and prayers for his mom. So if you get the chance and would go, that is tomorrow at 11, visitation is at 10. If you are out and about and up and going on social media, join me this week as we are going to break down one of the biggest... I don't even know the word that I want to use, but the story of David and Bathsheba is on schedule in our morning coffee chat. It's going to be good. Starts mornings at 9 a.m. I'd love to have you. Brother Larry will be back on Tuesday night with online Sunday school. For those of you who missed this morning, or for those of you who might have been with Miss Pat, or for those of you who are watching online, join Brother Larry at 7 o'clock on Tuesday night. It's Wednesday night. We'll be right back here. The book of Philippians. Larry, how'd it go this morning? Is all a good class? Okay. Did you catch me? Did you catch me?
No.
Okay. All right. So we're going to continue chewing through the book of Philippians. It's a good day, amen? Looks like the rain slowed down. Sun's out. I bet it's hot. I bet it is hot. So y'all be careful when we get out here. So if you'll stand, we are going to close in prayer. I'm going to ask Brother Larry to lead us and dismiss us. Folks, thank you so much for joining us today. It has been our pleasure to have you as part of our online family. We want to encourage you that if you are new to us, please go to our website, lovemyrbc.com, and click on guest card and just fill that out. It takes about 2 minutes and let us have a quick record of your attendance. Also, if you were unable to be here and you have not gotten in touch with Gloria on sending in your tithes or your offerings for the week, you can mail those in to P.O. Box 785 here in Forest City, 72336. Or you can go right back to our website, lovemyrbc.com, and right across the top there, you can find the button that says online giving. You can make a one-time gift, or you can set it up for your weekly donations and tithes. Thank you so much again for being here. Join me tomorrow morning as we start our weekly broadcast at 9 a.m. of our coffee chat, as we are going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 11, the story of David and Bathsheba. I love you guys so very much. If I can help you in any way, please let me know. In the meantime, have a great day, and if you see anybody, tell them about Jesus.